Maybe one of the 5 minutes passed. Three more people came in, so we've been waiting for
57. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us tonight for the Doctors Without Borders non-medical webinar. I'd just like to share a couple of housekeeping items with you, and then we'll get going. So my name is Tim Jones. I'm from the Field Human Resources Department at Doctors Without Borders. Leading the presentation tonight will be Melissa Beery. Melissa is an MSF Field Human Resources Officer and recruiter based in New York. Also with us tonight is JT Sims, an MSF logistician and project coordinator who's completed multiple missions, and he'll be sharing his life in the field experiences. Before we start, a couple of items for you to keep in mind. When you log in online, you should see your control panel, which has your audio options. If you have a mic and speakers on your computer, you're welcome to use this option. Otherwise, click the telephone button, and you'll see a call-in number and the codes to use. Please keep those numbers and the website URL available during the webinar, just in case your audio or video stalls. Tonight's presentation will last about 90 minutes. We'd like to ask you to hold your questions until the end, and then we'll respond at that time. So here's what we're going to cover tonight. And let me turn the meeting over to Melissa.
Great. Thank you all for joining us. Just want to give you a little bit of background about myself. My name is Melissa. I was a logistician in the field, and now I'm a recruiter here in the New York office. The reason why I picked these pictures tonight is just to show you that really, when you work in the field, especially the picture on the left of me fixing the car, you're always going to be pushed outside your comfort zone and learning something new. So I didn't know mechanics before I went into the field, but did learn that on the job. So that's me. And I'll hand it over to JT.
Oh, hello. My name's Jonathan Sims. I also go by JT. And I've been as Tim mentioned, a logistician and a project coordinator in the field. I began in India, where I did two consecutive assignments as a logistician for two consecutive years before moving on to South Sudan, where I became project coordinator for a year in a project called Nasir, which I'll talk a little bit about later in the presentation. But yeah, just like all of you, I don't have a medical background, but I managed to find my entry point into MSF through being a logistician, and I'll share a bit more about life in the field at the end of the presentation. Thanks.
Great. So we're just going to, basically the presentation is I'll talk about who we are as an organization, and then I'll hand it over to JT, who will talk about his life in the field, and then we'll end with how you go about applying to the organization. So what is Doctors Without Borders, or Médecins Sans Frontières? We'll be referring to Doctors Without Borders as MSF throughout the presentation. So really what we are is an emergency humanitarian medical organization. So what does that mean? It means that we are, when we open projects and when we treat patients in the field, it's really from an emergency perspective. So we're not a development organization. We're going to work with populations who've been affected by natural disasters, epidemics, exclusion of healthcare, and it really from this emergency perspective, with the idea that we will hand over the projects to another NGO, to the Ministry of Health, that we're just helping in an acute crisis. Just getting a hang of the mouse here. So MSF was founded in 1971 in the wake of the Biafra crisis. Basically, the Biafrans wanted to secede from the Nigerian government, and the Nigerian government was forcefully starving a portion of its population. At the time, we had physicians working with the ICRC, and they really were seeing this tragedy unfold and wanted to speak on behalf of the patients that they were serving, but it wasn't in the mandate to do that. So they ended up leaving and creating MSF, or Doctors Without Borders, in 1971. And one of our principles is to speak on behalf of those who were treating in the field. So I always think if you're interested tonight in learning more about working with us in the field, or if you just wanted additional information, our charter is really our guiding principles into how we work in the field, and a lot of times it's always going to be the thing that brings us back to why we're working in the field and who we are as an organization. So we really want people to read the charter, identify with the charter, but we'll talk more about it. So the areas that we'll talk is, oh, 1 second. We just have a quick technical thing. Can everybody hear us? If you can hear us, can you just type into the questions portion just to say that you can hear us? Okay, excellent. Okay, so thanks. We just had a technical, we were worried for a second. But fantastic, we're good to go. So talking about the charter is really our guiding principles of how we work in the field. So we'll talk more about neutrality, impartiality, independence, medical ethics, and also as volunteers, members make no claims for themselves. So really what we're looking for is, as a volunteer, if you decide to work with us in the field, you do get paid for the work that you do, but we are really looking for people who come to us with this volunteer spirit. So let's talk a little bit more about our charter and our principles. So first of all is independence. So what does it mean to be independent as an organization? So it means that we're financially independent. So it means we take no U.S. government funding, we take no extraction funding, we take no pharmaceutical funding, we take no funding that we feel would undermine the work that we do in the field. A lot of people would ask, does that really matter in the field where we're working? And yes, it does. Because it really, truly, if we have independent funding, then we can make the decisions based on the medical needs rather than waiting for different institutions or different bodies to fund us to open or close projects or to expand our programs. So independence, financial independence is extremely important to us. Neutrality, so it means that we don't take sides on a conflict. So really we are trying to be, of course, as neutral as possible when we work in the field. I would say that all of these principles have been challenged with the organization, and there is a book that's called Negotiations Revealed, MSF Negotiations Revealed, if you want more information about how we have been challenged in our guiding principles. But so the idea for the neutrality standpoint is that we're going to treat all sides in a conflict, and even if it's not a conflict, we're going to make sure that so, for example, I worked also in South Sudan, like JT, and when we're working in the places that we work, if people are excluded from healthcare, we want to try to find why aren't different populations coming to our clinics. We really want to make sure that everyone has access to independent, neutral care. So, another one of our principles is impartiality. So what that means is that we're going to treat those who need our services first when we do have a clinic or a health post or are running a hospital. Of course, in all of our health clinics, there are no weapons allowed in any of the doors. So this is just a picture in Afghanistan in 2011 of just one of the health structures that we're working in. Another one part of our charter is this medical ethics and innovation. And so this is a picture of South Sudan in 2013 in Yida refugee camp, where I actually was as a logistician. And so one of the things that I find so exciting about working for MSF is that we really decide, based on the medical needs of patients, how we're going to intervene. So when I was in this refugee camp, what we were finding was that children under the age of 5 were dying at a rapid rate of upper respiratory infections. And we knew that there was this vaccine, this PCV vaccine, that could help prevent some of those infections. But at the time, we were of course, working there, this wasn't standard of care, especially, and it wasn't available because we were working in a very remote setting. And so us as a team, we said, you know, we really think we need to implement this vaccine. We think it's medically necessary for the patients that we're serving. So we decided to do a vaccination campaign. Some of the challenges of this is that the refugee camp, the only way to access the camp was by plane, and the only way to get there was during the dry season, because during the rainy season, the plane couldn't land all of the time. So there was a lot of preparation, a lot of planning. I know JT will talk about his time in South Sudan and the same thing. One of my roles as a logistician was to test the runway to see if, and the way we would test it was to drive a Land Cruiser and put the brakes on and see how far the Land Cruiser sunk into the mud to decide whether or not the plane could land. So you think about, how are we going to get vaccines that need a certain cold chain to this very remote place in South Sudan? In addition, the population were refugees, so again, in flux, meaning that, you know, it's not their home that they're staying in. And the part of the vaccination was a three-part vaccine taken over 3 months. And so again, there was a lot of pushback saying, you know, how are we going to be able to implement this vaccine? But we as a team said, we thought, think it's medically necessary, and we're able to indeed carry this vaccine out. So we had a huge vaccination campaign and vaccinated 5,000 children and had over a 95% coverage rate. So that's just one example of the many ways that you working in the field with MSF and us as an organization really believe that we have to continue to improve our medical innovative ways in the field to treat the acute needs of the patients that we're working with. So advocacy, you know, often many people hear about MSF because you hear about our press releases or you read about some part of our services that we've been doing. And one of the really important things is to speak on behalf of, again, speak about the things that we think are important, which of course are the medical needs of our patients. So one of the things, this is just a picture of in New York in 2011, there was a patent law that was coming under fire that would have raised the generic prices of ARVs or many of the drugs that we use in the field. And we put a lot of pressure saying, you know, this law cannot be changed because we won't be able to afford the medicines for our patients and our patients won't be able to afford them. Another thing that we're doing currently is this going along the same lines of this PCV vaccine is asking for $5 a shot. So the idea is that currently different this vaccine can be procured for many different prices, and we want access to this PCV vaccine for $5 each. So again, advocacy is a big part of what we do here at MSF to make sure that not only are patients treated in the field, but also that we have the best access to the resources that we need. So if you think about working with us, or if you're here just to get more information, this is just a visual about where we work. So the majority of our programs are in Africa, Southeast Asia, and increasingly in the Middle East. 59% of our programs are in unstable context. So if you think about working with us, you know, you have to just keep that in mind. We have 32,000, now it's around 35,000 people that work for the organization, and 85% of those are locally hired staff. So what that means is the majority of people that work for the organization are hired from the communities in which we work. So for example, in South Sudan, they were the refugees. That was the majority of our staff. We had a staff of about 300, and 290 were Sudanese, and the rest were international staff. So you can read these statistics here, but I think often people find really interesting that our number one surgery in the field is C-section. So a lot of people want to know, why would we open a program or start a project? often we're already on the ground, and then something may occur, or we're going to do what we call an exploratory mission, where we send a team to decide whether or not we should intervene. So one of the reasons we would open a program would be, of course, armed conflict. So, of course, this is a picture of Syria, 2013. You can see in the background, it's an inflatable hospital. So, again, it really depends what our intervention is going to be depending on the needs of the patient. But often, in an armed conflict setting, you know, there, yes, of course, you're going to see trauma and you're going to see effects of the war, but also the health system often collapses. And so we're still delivering babies. We're still providing the primary health care for the population that's been impacted by the conflict. Okay. Another reason we would open a program is epidemic response. By now, almost everyone knows what this is a picture of, but it's an Ebola treatment unit. So other epidemics that we have responded to, of course, are cholera, malaria, outbreaks. So, of course, this Ebola outbreak was the largest, and we were able to be very, very reactive because often we're in the field and we hear of something and we can decide whether or not we are intervening. So, for example, I was on an HIV project in Malawi. And we heard of a lot of watery diarrhea diarrheal cases and did an exploratory mission to find out if we needed to do a cholera intervention and ended up needing to open a cholera intervention. So again, most of the time we're going to be providing primary health care or supporting the Ministry of Health, but then we also, of course, hear of things on the ground and can respond quickly. So malnutrition, in some cases with us, we would open projects just focused around malnutrition or malnourished children, but often it's a component of all of our programs. So for example, when I was in Yida in the refugee camp, we had inpatient therapeutic feeding center, but we were also treating children in an outpatient basis. And so if you see the woman with the yellow scarf, she's holding in her hand something called a ready-to-use food. One of the names of it is Plumpy Nut. And so what happens now, because this new product has been developed, is that moms can come, have their babies assessed, and if their babies and children maybe were worried about the nutritional content of their diet, we can prescribe them this thing called Plumpy Nut, and they can be treated at home rather than an inpatient basis. So natural disasters, often people, when they think about MSF or they think about Doctors Without Borders, they think about natural disasters, but it's really only about 5% of what we do. So if you're thinking about working in the field with us, it's more primary healthcare rather than natural disasters. But this is a picture of an American surgeon doing surgery a couple days after the earthquake in Haiti. Other natural disasters, of course, are the Nepal earthquake, floods in Pakistan. So if there is a natural disaster, we will see if there's a medical need for us to respond and see if that is indeed possible. So just to give you an idea of what our areas of focus are, you can read, of course, many of the things that we're seeing in the field are the neglected tropical diseases, sexual violence, mental health, vaccinations, malnutrition, and of course, emergency response. So just to give you a little bit more background, as you can see from this picture, as I said, the majority of the staff that we hire are locally hired from that community. So the physician or the nurse or the clinical officer who's doing the consultation, they're from the community that they're working in. And the person with the MSF t-shirt is the international staff. So often when you go to the field with us, you'll be in a supervisory training, teaching, and coaching role. So just to keep that in mind, that's really what we're looking for, people who have that experience. Just like here in the U.S., one of the barriers to access to healthcare is is access. And so often in the field, instead of waiting for patients to come to our clinics or come to the Ministry of Health clinics, we will go to where we think patients are, or we will try to do an assessment if patients aren't coming to our clinic. So that may mean you do a mobile clinic such as this in a boat in Congo. We were in Malawi, we were doing mobile clinics in vehicles, but we've done mobile clinics, you know, via walking many distances and holding a clinic under a tree. It really just depends on the needs of the population. So hospital support. So often, I think people think that we go into communities or we go into countries and start our own programs, our own medical outreach, but we always work with, if there is an existing Ministry of Health, and in some cases, it means just taking over part of the services of that clinic. So this is a picture of Sudan in 2005. This portion of the hospital was built by MSF for a sleeping sickness program. Once that had gotten under control, it was turned back over to the Ministry of Health and became a maternal health ward. So again, if you think about going to the field with us and maybe you're a construction person, this is definitely something, a semi-permanent structure that we could build in the field, that you might be tasked with building in the field. Just to give you an idea, often I think people think of us, you know, working very remotely in a tent in the middle of nowhere, which is definitely true. But we also do work in high functioning, you know, like we have a project in Jordan, in Amman, where the surgical suite is just like something that you would walk into here in the U.S. So, of course, that requires different skill set from our staff that we hire for the field. So on the upper left-hand corner is just one, a picture of, you know, a highly functioning OR, and then the one in the lower left-hand corner is a house that's part of the house was turned into an operating room. And then, of course, on the right hand is Haiti. Again, not the best circumstances to do surgery, and of course that's not what our ideal is. We're doing surgeries then for the acute crisis, and then waiting for, we had an inflatable hospital that was delivered there, and we could start surgery in a more secure setting. But just to give you an idea that I think often people think you're going to be in this remote community area, but you may be also in a city working with MSF. So treatment of infectious disease, one of the things that's really difficult, working with patients affected by multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis is the length of the medicine, and also that there hasn't been many new medicines developed. And so often in the field, we will also not only provide the medical services, but also provide mental health or counseling support, which could look in many different ways, could be, you know, providing support groups or building community involvement in the treatment and the patient care. Another reason, too, is to, of course, try to support our patients from the stigma that many of these diseases have. So just from a logistical standpoint, because many of you tonight probably are logisticians or are thinking about working with us in that capacity, is that some of the things you have to think about when you're doing, let's say, just a vaccination campaign, and I don't just say just a vaccination campaign because it is difficult, but you have to think about crowd control, you have to think about waste disposal, you have to think about, in the upper left-hand corner of the screen, the cold chain, and then you also have to think about community mobilization. How are we going to get the word out to let people know that this vaccination is going to come? So I think it really takes, in the field, a team to get everything done. Basic need support, so sometimes we may be the first actors on the ground, and that may be a role that we play for a small period of time. Which could be providing some basic need support. So this is Syria 2013. We knew it was getting cold in the community and people didn't have access to blankets and things, so we were doing a distribution of that when I was in YIDA, we were doing a distribution of cooking materials and some cleaning materials just to help with infection control. So many of you maybe tonight are interested also in water and sanitation. Again, it's a big part of the success of our project and also the health of populations that we're serving. So we are looking for water and sanitation specialists to help us. So that can be anywhere from simple things of making sure that the water is chlorinated in our project to helping oversee drilling of a borehole in a project. We just like this picture because it really kind of shows, I think, the bread and butter of MSF, and I'm not just saying that because I'm a logistician. I'm saying that because I think it's one of the things that makes us really successful in the field is that we can be so reactive because we've built these processes and things that we've put into place. So, again, if you look on the lower left-hand corner, that's the inflatable hospital in Haiti that had been put up five or seven days after the earthquake. In the upper right-hand corner is our logistics, one of our logistics warehouses. And so let's say you are working in a primary healthcare clinic, you hear of a cholera outbreak, and you think the catchment area of that outbreak will be a couple hundred people. You can order a kit that will be shipped from Bordeaux, within a couple of days to the project without having to have a physician or you as a logistician or an administrator write down all of the needs that you might have because these kits are already ready to be shipped to the field. So here's just a picture of inside the kits, just to give you an idea of what one might look like. We may have some medical people on the call tonight, which is great. But we have two things that you can download for free, essential drugs and our clinical guidelines. So because we have over 138 nationalities working for the organization, we have to have standards and protocols put in place so that no matter if you're a logistician, an administrator, or a nurse, you can do the same standard of care. And so these are two things that you can download for free that helps give you a better idea of what our guidelines are and what drugs we have available in the field. So now I'm going to hand it over to Jonathan or JT to talk about his experience and his time in the field.
Great. Thanks so much, Melissa. And by the way, Melissa was my initial recruiter, and I was hired to join MSF in 2011 after an interview with Melissa. So I'm really thankful to her and also for giving me a great introduction and making this next part, I think, pretty easy because she already covered so much. So I'm not going to talk so much on all of the specifics of what I've done as a logistician and a project coordinator. I'll sort of get to that tangentially, I believe, but I'm going to give you a little bit more of an idea of kind of life in the field and what to expect if you were to join MSF when you reach the project. So this is just a map to give you an idea of South Sudan. I think we've been talking about South Sudan a lot this evening, but that's because it is one of the countries that we do send a large number of international staff to. And as Melissa mentioned, both she and I have worked there. I worked in the northeast in Upper Nile State in a project called Nasir, very close to the Ethiopian border. And as Missy mentioned, she worked in Unity State in Yida, closer to the Sudanese border. So this is a very good visual representation of what it can be like when you first arrive in the project, especially if it's during the rainy season. Melissa touched on this. Our airstrip in Nasir was no exception. As you see here, we had hired, so I was a project coordinator at that time, but our technical logistician working with the national staff tech log assistant hired these daily laborers to help literally by hand bail out the tire treads in this muddy airstrip to try to help dry it out in time for the plane to land. And during the rainy season throughout the world, but especially in Nasir, the timing is everything. So in South Sudan. So what we did is, unfortunately, a different organization landed their plane while it was already a bit wet and created these tire treads, which we then had to try to hope would dry out quickly enough for our plane to land. But when I arrived, I actually had to arrive by boat. A along the Sobat River, which connects to the White Nile, 3 days boat journey from the state capital because of this type of airstrip condition. But it just gives you an idea, and as Melissa mentioned, part of the job of a technical logistician or, say, an all-around logistician in the project would be to work with the national staff team to ensure that the airstrip is safe to land. And needless to say, it was not at this time. We had to wait a few more days for it to dry out. This is just a picture of the outside of our hospital, MSF in Nasir, along that Sobat River that I mentioned. A beautiful context. I mean, everywhere, depending on where you would be assigned, should you be selected and decide to join MSF, you can work in any number of contexts. But Nasir was pretty unique within South Sudan to be in this great location along the river, and it even had the nickname of Nasir Paradise amongst our international staff team. This is an example of the boats that I arrived in, on the, as I mentioned earlier, but they were primarily used for outreach. So our community health workers, local staff, our international team of doctors and nurses would go out and do outreach into the community, whether it was vaccination campaigns, whether it was TB default or tracing along the river using these boats. This is another just example of flying the MSF flag on the river. You know, a lot of our activities do also take place by automobile, of course. This is actually also TB defaulter tracing, tuberculosis defaulter tracing with a national staff team. This is the tuberculosis HIV supervisor together with some patients and a driver. And oftentimes, as a logistician, if you were to take that position, you would join on this trip. And not to mention be responsible for the mechanics and the upkeep of the vehicle together with your national staff team. And our project was very similar to the one in Yida that Melissa talked about. We had, when I began anyway, 12 international staff from 11 different countries, which is great, but also 203 national staff. So that was the majority of our team. And this picture I put here to kind of give an idea of the different types of staff. This is World TB Day in 2014, December 1st. We were doing a community sensitization about, World AIDS Day on December 1st, and we're doing a community sensitization about HIV and AIDS. In the forefront here is Mading. He is a national staff, but actually from the capital. So he was given the designation of what we call INPAT, kind of a made-up word, a play on expat, but from the country, but not from the area. So he was a clinical officer, which is close to the equivalent of doctor in South Sudan. And behind him is Stella, and she is an international staff midwife from Uganda. And Stella was amazing. And I just want to use this story, this opportunity of this picture to tell a little bit of a story, which I think was pretty amazing and pretty unique in MSF. Stella, I believe, was one of the first midwives, if not the first, I have to confirm that, to help to deliver a baby aboard an MSF airplane. And the circumstances that surrounded that were that one of our nearby projects, we used to have surgical cases flown into Nasir because we had the surgical capacity and not every project in South Sudan did. And so they would fly in oftentimes women who maybe needed an emergency C-section, things of this nature. And they actually flew Stella to another project where a woman needed a C-section. And she wanted to do it there with the limited resources they had, as Melissa mentioned, but could not do that. So they wanted to bring them back to Nasir where the surgeon was, of course, because she needed the surgeon to help assist her. And she warned that the woman could not get on the plane because she was so close to delivering. She had twins. Unfortunately, one of the fetuses was already deceased inside of her, but she was able to deliver the second child aboard the plane unexpectedly, as Stella had kind of warned against on the en route to Nasir. And when they were on the way, of course, the mother was amazed and couldn't believe that this actually happened. And what happens in South Sudan is oftentimes they will name the child based on what is happening during that month. So say it's the rainy season, for example, a very popular male name is Nial, because it means the rain. So when it was time to name this child, everyone thought, well, are they going to name it after after Stella? Will they name it after the season? And they decided on a very interesting name. So there's no Nuer name, because that was the local language and the local tribe for in an airplane, say, for example. So they used the word for in the middle of the bush, or in the middle of nowhere, which is Nieri. And that's a very nice name for a girl as well. It was a baby girl that was born, Nieri. But instead of just stopping there, they also asked, well, what is this plane called? And for those of you out there who might know something about single-engine prop planes, the plane is a Cessna, single-engine Cessna. And they said, well, what is the midwife's name? And, of course, it's Stella. So the full name of the child was Nieri Cessna Stella Bull, which was the father's name. So it's pretty unique and amazing story and great circumstance, and she did a great job. And here you have, you know, after one of the planes may have landed, we have our national staff, technical logistician. His name is Peter Janoup, a Nepalese doctor named Bipin, and a German surgeon named Bernard. And you see a couple of 2x4s over there on the side, but basically, yeah, you can't really see it in this picture, but there would be a number of supplies unloaded from the plane, which is likely taking place in that truck behind them. Every time a plane would land, it would carry passengers, national, international staff coming in and out, patient referrals, and also supplies. And so the logistician would be responsible for coordinating that landing. Here you just have a picture of the inside of the pediatric ward, just to give you an idea of kind of how that would look. I mean, we do our best in the field working with the medical team, Watsan specialists, logisticians, to keep as high of a standard as possible, as high of a standard of care as possible in our medical facilities. But as you see, it's very basic. At the same time, there's no shortage of opportunity to make improvements. Mm-hmm. And this was one of the older pediatric wards. Then shortly after, we built a new IPD ward immediately adjacent to that. So yeah, this just gives you an idea of the expat living compound. So for the international staff, these sort of mud and straw huts we call tukuls. Very famous word within MSF, but it's pretty cool because each one of these would be for one individual international staff. So you get your own little huts. You know, the living conditions will vary depending on where you are placed. I don't have any pictures in this presentation of India because I may just take too much time to go over two complete projects. But my living conditions in India were completely the opposite. We were in a large house with two floors. Everybody had their own indoor room, indoor bathroom, plumbing, all of that. So it all depends on where you're assigned and what kind of project you come into. But as long as, in addition to the key principles of MSF of neutrality, impartiality, and independence, some of the key tenets of an international staff member are flexibility and adaptability. So if you can kind of keep that in mind when it comes to the living conditions, you'll be quite okay. This is just a picture of myself that was shown at the beginning, but the reason I wanted to include it is to kind of give you an idea that it's not all, you know, active kind of work, unloading planes, going on TV, defaulter tracing. Sometimes you are, you know, at a desk, just like you would be in the United States. So here when I was project coordinator, I had to keep up with a lot of emails. I had to coordinate a lot of things. I had to be in touch with the head of mission in terms of access negotiation, especially during the ongoing current conflict there, and having meetings with a certain high-level authority. So there was a lot to prepare on that end. So it wasn't all being up and mobile and running around. Sometimes you're doing desk work as well. But it was not so bad, as you see, and with the smile on my face. And I kind of wanted to close with this photo of one of our most memorable patients. His name is Kawer. And I think it just helps to kind of contextualize things a bit about why we do what we do. Kawer, 7-year-old boy, and before I go any further, you know, of course, you have to have, you know, the consent of the patient if you were to take any pictures in the field. So I talked to him and I talked to his father, could I take this snapshot? Because I saw Kawer sitting there every day. He was actually in our hospital for over 3 months, almost 4 months. And that's because he was the victim of a gunshot wound as a result of what is all too common in that area, a practice of cattle raiding. So even before the current conflict broke out, seasonally, when the nomadic tribes will move with their cattle, other tribes and subclans will try to take advantage of that and sort of rob those individuals of their cattle. So there can be actual fighting as a result of that. And Kawer was the innocent victim of one of those gunshots. And unfortunately, the surgery that he needed involved it required a urologist, which we did not have that specialization either in our project or in the country. So our medical team leader, who I worked very closely with, and I didn't mention earlier, as a project coordinator, oftentimes, depending on the size of the project, you're responsible for supervising and working together with the other non-medical international staff. And oftentimes, if it's a big enough project, you'll have a counterpart, a medical team leader, who's mainly responsible with working together with the medical international staff. And then, of course, everyone collaborates, and it's all a big team. It's not hierarchical. But just to give you an idea, I had a great medical team leader named Donald, and he found out about a urology camp that actually another NGO was doing, which invited other patients from MSF or from the National Ministry of Health who needed this specialization, they could be flown in. But as I showed in the earlier picture, during the rainy season, it's not so easy to fly patients or staff or supplies in and out. It all depends. You have to time it correctly. And so when this first round of this camp was taking place, we could not fly Kawer out in time because of the condition of the airstrip. And so he missed that. And so I believe it was a 4-times-a-year camp, so it was every 3 months. So he had to wait for the next round. And the medical team decided his condition was enough that it could be maintained within our hospital, but of course he would need this surgery at a later date. And so Kawer was there every day. He was not bedridden. He was outside of the hospital. And what he was doing was taking the mud, the very same black cotton soil that you saw there in the airstrip that's famous to the area, and molding these little clay cows, basically. And I found that very interesting and poignant because of the importance of cattle, of course, to the people, but, you know, very much his injury was the result of that longing for the cattle in many ways. And I don't believe that irony I'm sure that irony was lost on him, but at the same time, it was somehow very poignant and artistic that he decided to create these small clay cows on his own. And not to mention the fact that that soil and that muddiness was really much, very much the reason that he could not, unfortunately, leave to get the surgery he needed the first time around. And so Kawer was there for 3 months every day outside molding these cows, and everybody marveled at it. And I would walk by and I would say, you know, go along, very good in the local language, to kind of encourage him and what he was doing. And he always had this great smile on his face. So one day I just thought, let me just take a picture. And I asked his parents and they said it was fine. And later he also offered me one of these clay cows, which I thought was so nice. But I didn't know if I should just take the gift. So I traded with him my empty soda bottle, which I think he very much wanted as well, to make another kind of toy with. And also the juxtaposition with the red car, I think, makes this a very interesting picture. But Kawer was one of the most memorable patients that we ever had. And the happy ending of the story is he was able to then go out for the next camp and get the surgery that he needed, and came back, and we saw him after, and he was fine, and he was great, and he went home to be with his family. So it's just an idea. I mean, it's a bit of a medically leaning story, but at the same time, the entire team, as you can imagine, was involved in Kawer's care, both on the medical and the non-medical side, and involved in the logistics of getting him out and getting him the surgery that he needed. And it just is a reminder of kind of maybe the reasons why we do what we do as field international staff in the field.
Great. Well, thank you so much, JT. That was a great presentation and a great ending that kind of hopefully gets everyone excited about the potential of working with us in the field. So as JT so wonderfully said, that we're really looking for people who are flexible and adaptable. And it's not just because it's not because we're a disorganized organization. It's because things change often on the field, and we have to be ready for that type of change. So who does MSF recruit? You know, this presentation is going to focus much more around the non-medical staff, but just wanted to give you an idea. Of course, you can read here who we are recruiting for the field, but we'll talk more about the non-medical teams or positions. So what are the general requirements? Flexibility and availability, at least 2 years of professional experience. So if we do have medical professionals, 3 years for nurses, and for MDs, it's really your residency that's enough, so you don't need an additional 2 years after residency. The first assignment to be taken for 9 to 12 months, with the exception of our surgeons, OBGYNs, and anesthesia providers, where they're accepted for a shorter assignment, and that's just because they're on call usually 24 hours, 7 days a week. What else are we looking for? Ability to work with an international team. As JT said, you know, he worked with 10 different nationalities. Most people think that's the easiest part. So people say, oh, I can do that. But often that's hard because here in the U.S., you work with people and you can go home and have your relaxing life, whereas in the field you work together and then you live together. So it's just, for most of us, we haven't done that since college or university. So it's something to think about. Relevant travel or working in developing countries or remote rural parts of the U.S., so we want you to have been uncomfortable. We want you to get to Nasir and not feel like the conditions of where you're working won't be able for you to sustain for a 9 to 12 month commitment. So a proven track record that you've been there, you've done something, you've been uncomfortable before. Communication skills, managerial teaching training experience. So that means that we want you to have managed staff in the past, again, because usually you're going to go in a managerial role when you get to the field. Basic computer skills, like JT showed the picture of himself, you do have to still write reports, do many things with a computer, so you don't get away from that just because you go to the field with MSF. Commitment to our principles. There is no age requirement. For our medical professionals, we ask for 6 months clinical experience in the last 2 years. And we don't place couples on the first mission, and it's usually hard to get couples placement in the field anyway. Again, just because of the, we don't have that many international staff in the field, and then also to find two people a location where they can go together during the same time is difficult. Foreign language skills is a major asset, and really what we're talking about is French, and the reason why is of our five largest projects, four of them are French-speaking. It's not a requirement to work with us in the field, it just helps you to get to the field faster. So if you do have French, it's a fantastic asset. Increasingly also Arabic with us. Many times in the U.S., of course, people have Spanish, but last year we sent five Americans to Spanish-speaking contacts. So again, it's really the French that we're looking for. So if you do decide to apply, where are we tonight? Right now we're at number 3. You're getting more information about us. So we want you to decide where the organization you want to work for. And then there is an online application. We received 1,700 applications last year and went forward with 120 applicants. It's not to discourage you from applying. It's just to say we can be pretty selective in our recruitment process. So when you do apply, we just want you to provide as much information as yourself as possible. We will give you feedback we try to give people feedback 4 weeks after they apply. And if we decide to go forward, we do an in-person interview. Again, it's really to make sure that you're a fit for the organization and we're a fit for you. We also would recommend that you apply 4 to 6 months before you're ready to go to the field. This gives us time to do the interview, to do the screening, and so on. With MSF, you are applying for a pool of candidates rather than an individual position. So that means we want this flexibility to go where the needs are, rather than you telling us where you want to go and us trying to find you that match. But then once we do find you the match, that's also a competitive process, because so this is just an example of we need a field nurse in Central African Republic. MSF-USA and all sections are proposing their candidates, and then ultimately the field chooses who they think is the best suited for that project. So just we'll go a little bit more into the logistician, and JT, please jump in if you want to add anything. But so really we're looking for this kind of jack of all trade, of all trades, and specialists. So the type of specialist for logisticians that we're looking for is, of course, if you see on the upper right-hand corner, mechanics. So usually we have Land Cruisers, is Toyota Land Cruisers in our facilities. Then we also need supply experts, so people who can manage large supply warehouses, water and sanitation specialists, construction, and then electricians. So again, we would like people who have a deep expertise in those areas, but then also somebody who can do a little bit of everything. There isn't the perfect person that works for the organization. We've had logisticians come to us. Some have been worked for Hollywood in the movie industry because they've had to orchestrate these large movie sets and things. And we've also had, we have a horse logger who did horse logging in the middle of nowhere, U.S., and he's a logistician with us in the field. So there isn't a, we don't have like a specific degree that you need to have or exact skill set, but the technical expertise or knowledge or a general expertise in all these technical areas make you the best candidate. So for management, it could be like a construction person who's managed large teams, been a foreman in a construction, who has orchestrated things to be built or constructed. So administrators, JC, do you want to add anything with logisticians? Just so.
No, just that Melissa is exactly right with the varied backgrounds. My background is in communications, yeah, and also was sort of one of those wannabe Hollywood filmmakers and did some documentary filmmaking on my own before I joined MSF. But really my entry point into the humanitarian sphere was with the Peace Corps. So I have met a number of colleagues in the field who also have that background. But just as Melissa mentioned, jack of all trades is great if you're open and flexible to do any number of things. And we'll get into the administration next. But also if you do happen to have a very specific background that you think would lend itself to any of the things that she's describing, then kind of all of the above, it's worth going ahead and applying and see where you might fit in. Because when I was in the Peace Corps, I wasn't really sure. I worked with MSF in the field and kind of collaborated with them on some vaccination campaigns and nutrition programs. But at the same time, I didn't really know where would my entry point be, right? But I think that for all of you out there who are not quite sure, it's just worth taking a shot and trying to kind of emphasize where you may lie on that sort of jack of all trades specialist spectrum and see how it goes.
Yeah, exactly. I'm glad you said that because I remember when JT and I interviewed together, you know, talking about the Peace Corps and how that was a very formative experience for him and his skill set that really was transferable to the field with us. And then administrators really, so in all of our projects, of course, we have to pay our staff. We have to put people on contract. We have to give people holidays, vacation time. We have to also give them medical care. So like JT said, you had 200 staff in this year, or over 200 staff. So if you think about how are you going to pay our staff where there isn't a formal banking system, so you have to pay people in cash. How are you going to get the cash there? How are you going to pay them in a secure way? How are you going to document their hours so that we make sure that they are indeed getting paid what they need? Another thing that happened to me when I was in South Sudan is the South Sudanese government decided they wanted to give certain Muslims 5 days of vacation and Christians 3 days of vacation for a holiday. I can't remember which holiday it was. But the majority of the staff that we hired were actually refugees. So do we have to follow the national guidelines of the holidays of that community? I was really glad I was a logistician and not an administrator because I didn't have to answer that question. I just had to think about it. So really the administrators are the backbone in the sense of, you know, they keep hiring staff. If we need to have any disciplinary or promotions opportunities, they really help manage the budget, make sure that where our funds are spent are being spent in the right way. So the type of people that we're looking for is, of course, the person that has, like, the accounting background, the bookkeeping background, but then also much more of a generalist. So maybe somebody who's been an executive director of an NGO or who's been a human resource officer who's worked with onboarding people and making sure that they have the payroll and the benefits that they need. And then also, of course, we have to do contracts. So people who are clear about how to write contracts and think about the contracts that we work with in the field. So administrators are really extremely important to us in the field. I think we talked about this. I'm just going to go.
Yeah.
So just JT can help me out a bit too, but just wanted to, a lot of people, when they think about working with us in the field, security is their number one concern. And so just wanted to show kind of this slide to give you an idea that we are structured in our approach and that there are people who are thinking about security and how we manage security in the field. So this is just a typical program in Chad. So in every country, we would have a country or capital coordination team. And you can see that in the left-hand corner and who that's made up of. Of course, there's many more people that are on that team. And then we have multiple field projects. So we have, in this example, a surgical project and a vaccination project. And really, the field coordinator is the one who is in charge, ultimately responsible for security, but of course, working with the capital coordination team. And so I think more often than not, people are very concerned with security before they go with the field, and then you get to the field and you find out how restrictive MSF is, and people can feel a bit suffocated in the sense that in Yida, in the refugee camp where I was, we could never go walk alone. We had to be back in the compound at 6 o'clock. We had to always have a radio with us, so someone always had to know where we were, and that security protocol was changing depending on what was developing in the community. So I don't know, JT, I'm just going to have you jump in if you...
Yeah, exactly. And with our teams, our international and national staff teams working together, a lot of what we do in the field, the decisions we take, you know, having a daily team meetings in certain contexts or weekly in others, it's meant to be very much an associative model. And so we talk about MSF as an association, as a worldwide movement, more so than we do as, you know, as an organization, or certainly without any kind of corporate language. But the reason for that is everybody's voices and opinions are valued when it comes to meetings and decisions we take, in a way, except for when it comes to security. And security is much more hierarchical, and it's that way for a reason. And the project coordinator working closely with the head of mission really makes these security decisions in the field, and they just have to be adhered to, and that's for a reason, as Melissa mentioned. I mean, we've worked, MSF is present in nearly 70 countries in many difficult contexts, some more challenging than others, some in conflict zones, some not, but our adherence to these security protocols is really what helps ensure our safety, in addition to what I often refer to in the field as kind of a security triangle. And so it's important to note that in virtually all of our projects, say for maybe a few capital locations, we never have, there is never the presence of any armed guards. We also don't use necessarily high walls or barbed wire. These are kind of deterrence factors when we talk about security, and that's kind of what people think of as the base. At the same time, you know, you can think of avoidance as a strategy and not necessarily going to crowded places and not maybe getting out in the market, but we do encourage our teams in certain contexts to really get to know the local community and to visit the homes of our team members if they're invited. It all depends on the situation, but really our primary security in the field is our acceptance. That's kind of at the top of this triangle. And so the fact that we do employ so many local staff from the community, the fact that we do treat everyone from all sides, the fact that even if there is an armed conflict happening, that people who may be a part of that conflict, their wives and their daughters and maybe even themselves have already been patients with us. And so for that reason, we are very often very much accepted in the local communities, and that helps ensure our safety as well. But as Melissa mentioned, just to wrap up, security is very much a top-down decision, and you have to be kind of comfortable with that going in.
Yeah. Okay, so just a couple of pictures of how we do that. Again, of course, you know, not letting arms into our hospital settings. Communication, like JC said, you know, talking to everybody, telling them who we are, making sure that we're treating everybody and that people have access to our care. And then, of course, that we do have security. So as a logistician, you may be you would be responsible for making sure that equipment is working. So as this woman in the lower left-hand corner, and then the quality of our medical program. So just we want to make sure that we have enough time for you guys to ask us any questions that you might have. So just wanted to go over what benefits, as I said at the beginning, we do provide a salary. It's $1,933 per month that goes directly into your U.S. bank account. We provide room and board in the project and in the country that you're living, and then round-trip transportation to and from the field. We provide health, dental, and vision insurance the entire time you're in the field with us, and then for 3 months after you return, access to a 401k plan, emergency evacuation coverage. You do get vacation when you go to the field, 25 days for every 12 months, and that's prorated depending on the length of your mission, and access to psychosocial support. Yes, you do get paid when you work with us. Just a quick thing, we don't talk so much about it at the beginning, but there's many ways that you can make long-term careers with MSF. I've been with MSF since 2009, JT since 2011. But what I really love about this picture is it's a nurse and she's digging out a car. So this idea of flexibility, adaptability, no matter what profile you are. If you just came to get more information tonight, there's so many wonderful things that you can have access to. I would say one of the things is this blogs, field blogs. A lot more people are wanting to blog about their experience, so you can get much more hands-on knowledge about what's happening real-time on the field blogs. Blogs at .msf.org. So, again, we would encourage you to apply if you're interested. I know that there are some people on tonight's call that may be outside the U.S., which is fantastic. So you can go to our website, doctorswithoutborders.org, and when you drop down, it will ask you what your country of residence is, and then depending on what your country of residence is, you will apply to an operational center depending on that, and so our website can direct you that way. Also, we get people often who maybe you're a medical professional tonight who is in the U.S. but not licensed in the U.S. to practice. So it would be a foreign-trained doctor in the U.S., and you can apply to the organization. We just ask that you have the 6 months clinical experience in the last 2 years again. So let's hand it over to questions so that we have about 20 minutes for questions. Is that right? Okay, great. Yeah, 20 minutes for questions. So if you just want to type them into the question frame, we'll try to just provide you as much feedback as we can. So it's just going to take us a little bit to look at what the questions are and get a sense of how we should answer. Oh, epidemic. Another thing, too, is if you have very specific questions about yourself and your application, which often we get, so if this is a better forum for more general questions, we will provide you with an email at the end that you can email questions to, and we will respond. So I would really use this forum now for maybe general questions that that we could answer for everyone. Because if you have very specific questions about your own profile, we can do that in a later date. So I like this one, and maybe JT, you can answer it. What is the most important skill of a field logistician?
Yeah, I hate to sound repetitive, but I would say the flexibility and the adaptability again, knowing that you may have to do things that are outside of your job profile, being patient, being able to work well with others and work with national staff and having some managerial skills. I think that's very important, as Melissa mentioned at the beginning. It's not only about your own technical skills and administrative skills, but it's also about how well can you manage teams. So I think that would be my answer there.
Great. So someone had a question about how long, so once you go through the process, how long do you wait before you get an assignment? And we would say that people are tending to wait 4 to 6 months before they get an assignment. But if they know French, it's a much quicker process. So then it becomes sometimes 2 to 3 months. For almost all logisticians and financial administrators, there is additional technical training before you go to the field. And that technical training would be more about exactly what you'll be doing in the field. Okay, so we're just looking.
Paramedical one next.
Yeah, financial. So maybe do you want to answer financial coordinator? What's the, in general, like someone asked about a logistician,
sure.
What would be a financial, the skill set?
Sure. So that would be much more of those specific skills that Melissa mentioned earlier. Skills that I don't necessarily have. My first entry, actually, as a logistician, we talked about administrators. Actually, there was a position back in 2011 called logistical administrator, so I had to do a bit of both. There was a finance aspect, there was the HR aspect, there was the supply aspect, and I got to work with some very good financial coordinators that we call FinCos, and they may have had a background in any number of organizations. They don't necessarily have to have, you don't necessarily have to have come from another nonprofit or international NGO. You may have a background in banking, you may have a background at a financial firm, and you're just interested in international work, or you've traveled internationally, and you have some managerial experience, you could also be eligible to be a FinCo with an MSF. But I would say, and maybe Melissa can answer this more specifically as an HR recruitment officer, is it's not often that we would necessarily place someone in a first mission directly as a financial coordinator. Am I correct? Oftentimes, you may start in more of an administrative role, but maybe I'm mistaken.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends on your profile. So we've had some people come to the organization who are like COOs or CEOs of companies. Of course, they can go right into that role. But often you're like JT said, we want you to get that field experience rather than more at the capital level. Someone also had a question about human resource managers. Yes, so there is a specific profile that we're looking for of just HR managers. So because many of our teams are so large, that often we need somebody who can help from that capacity. So you don't have to necessarily have the financial background, because you could just go with us as a human resource coordinator.
Good point, yeah. True. What else coming in? I also have a physical science engineering background. Yeah, we can get some of that.
So specific skills. Okay, so currently, for someone asked about a field coordinator, and yes, previous managerial experience is required for that role and for almost all of our roles. So definitely, if you can get that experience, you know, managing other staff or managing people. Someone said if you can apply from living in Argentina, of course. So again, go to our website. There'll be a drop-down list of your country of residence, and then it will tell you where to go to apply most effectively. Let's see what else. So someone asked about a real salary. So with so yes, you start what we call is the $1,900 a month and an indemnity. So we have that salary for the first year of your work with the organization, and then after that you jump on a salary grid. But I would just say, as an organization, we really try to keep the salaries at a modest cost because we believe that's one of the tenets of working with the organization, that you are a volunteer, you go with this volunteer spirit. So compared to other organizations, we pay definitely fairly and adequately, but you will never make a ton of money working for the organization.
Exactly. But if I can be blunt, don't let that be a limiting factor.
Yeah.
Because what one great thing about being in the field is you're living in this team environment. As Melissa mentioned, there can be different interpersonal adaptations you have to make as a result of that. But you also share living quarters. Your room and board is covered. You have cooks. You have cleaners. You're not paying rent. You're not paying for groceries. So even that, what may seem like a small indemnity, actually can hold you over quite well, and you can use when you take your vacations and things like that.
Yeah.
So don't let that be a limiting factor.
Yeah, and then someone said, you know, what if you come straight out of getting your degree, but you have had done work on the side, or you feel like you have skills? So again, of course you can apply to the organization. You know, often people do their studies and work full-time. So we're just asking for this 2 years of relevant professional experience before you apply. But if you're doing that concurrently as you're studying, then of course you can apply to the organization. You know, I would say, like JT said, when in doubt, apply. We will give you feedback. So I would definitely say apply. One of the things, someone had a question about interns and volunteers. Yes. Our headquarters in the U.S. is in New York City, and so we do have intern and volunteer opportunities here in the office. Just go to the website, Doctors Without Borders, and you'll see work with us, and you can either work in the field or work in the office, and you'll see opportunities there. Someone asked, where does the technical training take place for before logisticians and financial administrators go to the field? It's usually Europe. Yeah, we get multiple countries and multiple places in Europe. So there is a big need, I would say, for financial coordinators in the field. This is a skill set that's really important to our field projects, as both JT and I said. So there is a great need. So again, if you have that skill, definitely apply.
And don't take my other word with a grain of salt. As Melissa mentioned, we do hire financial coordinators directly, so I may have misspoke a bit there.
No. But often people want to be in the field, and I think it's good to get, rather than stay in a capital setting. Okay. Some of these other questions seem like they're very specific about people's specific skills and specific questions, but actually this one I think is important. How do you deal with language barriers? So JT, I was wondering if you wanted to talk about working in a community.
Yeah, absolutely. So as Melissa mentioned, we both talked about, you know, the majority of our team are national staff who will then speak the local language. So you can definitely, oftentimes, especially for medical people when dealing with patients, you will have a fellow staff member who can be a translator for that. You know, if we're talking about non-medical volunteers, then certainly, yes, some members of your team, especially if you're supervising a large team of drivers and guards, they may not all speak English or French. They may only speak a local language. So, you know, part of it is working with your counterpart, because oftentimes there is a national staff team leader for those teams that can help with translation. But at the same time, it's great if you can learn a bit of the local language. That's not our main purpose of being there, but especially if you're in a project for a long period of time, it's great to make the effort to at least learn some greetings and be able to talk to people and how are you and how's your family, and to talk about food especially. We like to do that in the field. But yeah, when it comes to the language barrier, don't be concerned about that. There will be a number of members in your team who can speak both the local language and whether English or French, whatever you are fluent in.
So someone had a question about age. No, age is not. It's just anybody can apply if they have the relevant work experience. And then for language levels, we use the European standard. So it's A1, A2 is the basic, B1, B2 is intermediate, and C1 and C2 is fluent in the language. We don't need fluency, but we need upper intermediate level in French. And we do test that, not at the interview process, but at our information days, which is part of the recruitment process. So someone had another... so again, if you have specific questions, because I think some people have some very specific questions, please email us and we'll get back to you. And then for people who are living in the U.S. who maybe have just come to the U.S. And maybe have some temporary immigration status, if you're living in the U.S., we want you to apply to the U.S. So it doesn't mean you have to be a resident here, but apply here because you can go through the entire interview process while living here. But I would say, you'll want to have be living here about a year because the process takes a while to go through the entire thing. And then for IT specialists, increasingly we're developing more IT services in the field, the health information systems. And so we don't hire specific professionals currently who have an IT just an IT background, so we're looking for much more of a generalist, but that skill set, I think, will increasingly become something that we need in the field.
Yeah, and oftentimes technical logisticians in teams are also the IT responsible.
Right.
So you may have many other duties, but IT could be one of them. So if you have a specialization in that and you can do some other things too, then that could also be useful.
I think we can end on one thing. I liked, Catherine, your question about how do you stay healthy in the field, exercise and meals. JT, what did you do?
Yeah, I love to do yoga. I picked that up in India, actually. So that was a big part of my daily regimen was the morning yoga with the sunrise. And then depending on the security context where you are, you may or may not be able to go running. So some people will go running in the field to keep in shape. And depending on the community, they may look at you a little strange for doing that. I can remember running around a lake in India and people coming by a motorcycle and saying, hey, come on, I'll give you a ride. And I said, no, it's okay. I run. They said, why? What are you doing? No, I just want to get some exercise. So it depends on the situation. But, yeah, there's sometimes when you're in a more intense security context, you may have to stay in the compound more often. And so, I've had that Nepalese doctor we showed, he used to run laps around the compound. And, we do, team yoga together. Sometimes people will get together and watch different Pilates DVDs
yeah.
or things like that. So, yeah, there's a lot of opportunities, I think.
Yeah, we changed one of our tents into what we called the exercise tent.
Nice.
And so every day at 6:30, whoever wanted to would do like a video, like a Pilates or a certain video, or jump ropes are really a good, or if you can, like in the refugee camp I was in, we were able to play volleyball with the community, and that was amazing. So you could get out and play volleyball or soccer or football, depending on if the security rules allow it. So I think you can stay healthy in the field. You just have to make sure, like here, you make time for it. Okay, so I think, again, if you guys have any questions, specific questions, please email them to us, and we will respond to your question. But thank you all for staying so long and listening, and we really look forward to your applications. Thank you. Have a good night.